Issues Live. Your Issues Live. Join Greg Sobario along with Alvin Daly and WDJZ. 5:30 until 6 every Friday, where we deal with your issues live. Don't you dare miss it.
Welcome to Your Issues Live. Today we have a very special program for you, so please stay tuned and do not change that dial. We will be talking today to Frank and Robbie Pack about their mission trip that they have been going on and the life that they have been impacting. A lot of people, they are not really going on mission, or if they do go on mission, it's like they're going on a holiday, or they're going to just to enjoy themselves, to see the country, not to actually go and minister to these people and try to make a real change. We'll be talking about this in great depth with Frank and with Robbie. We want to welcome you, Frank, and welcome you, Robbie, to Your Issues Live.
And I want to say a special welcome to you, Frank and Robbie, also, knowing that you could really take time out of your time, come and to give an outline on and all the various missions that you guys have been on. There are people out there who still want to really go on the battlefield for Christ, because we have realized over the years that the way that the church has started out in the beginning, things have been taking another toll. And we want to just say, God be with you, and the Lord may continue to bless you and to keep you as you go along on your missions.
Your issues lie.
How long ago since you have accepted Christ?
I made a personal decision as an adult, 1981. I was in my office at work, and I had been had a lot of emotional pain inside from childhood and on, and I listened to the scripture being taught for over a year in a small church in a loving way, and I made a decision in the office at work, shut the door, I said, Jesus, I want you to be my teacher. I was very honest with him. I said, I've been hurt by so many pastors, so many people within the church. We're killing each other. I said, it shouldn't be this way. So I want you to be my teacher. I accept you today on that premise that you will teach me through your Holy Spirit the ways of the kingdom. And that was the way it was.
How long have you been married to Robbie?
We've been married for almost 39 years in August.
How did you receive your missionary call, Robbie?
I went to a meeting with Randy Clark of Global Awakening, and the first night that I heard him speak, he talked about bringing a team to Brazil the following year. It was in November of 99. And the team was going in September of 2000. And when he talked about it, God burned literally in my heart that I was supposed to go. And I remember shaking my head and looking heavenward, saying, God, me? You've got to be kidding. Because I felt like I was at a very low point, that I wasn't valuable to anyone, including God. And he made it infinitely clear that I was supposed to go. And I tried to learn as much as I could in the meantime, because I didn't want to practice on those poor unsuspecting Brazilians. And the rest, as they say, is history. I went with fear and trepidation. I think I learned more, benefited more than the Brazilians did, but God did show up. People were healed. I found out that when I pray, something happens. And it's exciting, because I had always had a huge compassion for people and didn't know completely what to do with it. And so I started to find out what God had built me for and why he had put certain things in and how I could use it in a constructive rather than a destructive way.
How long did you stay in Brazil?
That trip was, I believe, 10 days.
And for those 10 days, you mentioned you see the moving of God. Could you tell me one experience there in the moving of Christ, what actually had happened?
Well, at that point, I had been blessed as a team member, as they always are. The leadership will go down the line and pray for each team member before we start the meeting. And the Holy Spirit came very strongly on me, and I didn't go up right away to upstairs to the meeting. And when I finally joined the rest of the team members, they had called up youth to be prayed over. And one of the main leaders had prayed over a young girl, and God really directed my eyes toward her. And he prayed a very powerful prophetic word over her about how God was going to use her for a strong healing ministry. And she was very serious about what he said, but she looked very sad, and I didn't understand that. And so afterwards I found an interpreter, and I went up to her and I asked her why she was so sad. And she said so sincerely, "Oh, I want that with all my heart. But I have diabetes and I have to give myself a shot every day. Surely God couldn't use me until I'm completely healed myself." And I said, "Well, you see the name tag here?" I said, "That shows that I'm a team member and I don't have diabetes, but I'm giving myself a shot for some another medical condition." At that point I was. And I said, "And God is using me on the team, and God can use you as well." And the short story is that we got her parents' permission and blessing, and she asked if she could pray for her grandmother first, because her grandmother was scheduled to have cataract surgery the next week. And she prayed for her grandmother, and God healed both eyes. And the grandma was able to read a sign at the far end of the auditorium that I couldn't read clearly with my glasses on.
Wow.
And she started screaming and got so excited. And then a woman who had refused to have this young girl pray for her said, "Oh, can she pray for me next? Can she pray for me next?" And God healed her as well. But she thought that a child couldn't be used by God. And we found that the Holy Spirit that was in this young gal, who was, I believe, 12 or 13, was the same Holy Spirit that's in you and me.
As you talk about God using a child, first we have to understand also that as we talk about children, we realize that the Bible makes mention of children. When we have children, it is the gift of God to us, because we know that the children are God's heritage.
Yes.
So we have to realize that God can use anybody mm-hmm. he wishes to use. God uses anybody, and that's the reason why he even goes to say that the kingdom of heaven, in order for us to receive it and in order for us to get it, we have to learn to humble ourselves like a little child.
Your Issues Live on WDJZ.
You're listening to Your Issues Live with Greg Savario along with Alvin Daly. We have Frank and Robbie Pack here with us, and we're talking about the mission, going on a mission trip.
Holy Spirit, come with your power, open my heart, and come within. Holy Spirit, come with your glory, shine your light on me, shine so brightly, yeah. Holy, holy, holy Spirit, holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy Spirit, holy, holy, holy. Yes, Holy Spirit, come with your power. We hear your voice, O Lord, and follow your words.
Frank, What's the most memorable part of a mission that you have actually went on?
Well, I give you an example. It just came to mind, and we often minister to Messianic congregations, small ones, some big, 1,500 members, but our heart is with small churches. And we were called out, a friend of mine, to a distant village to pray and to minister to a congregation. And the actual rabbi said afterwards, young rabbi said, about 10:30 at night, "Frank, are you available to go and pray with this lady pastor?" And I said, "Sure." And we went through the dark and came to her home. And she lay in bed, as one room apartment with kitchen, everything in one room. She had broken her back when she fell from the ladder. And she fell off the ladder when her pastor walked by and forbid her from associating with Messianic Jews or Jews. And that's when she fell off and she broke her back and she was bedridden. She couldn't move in bed. And so with the translator, I spent maybe an hour and a half with her. And a lot of pain, and this had happened maybe a month or two before. And so I talked to her very gently, and through the leading of the Holy Spirit, brought her to the point of asking if she could forgive the pastor who really had spoken a curse over her life. And we talked gently through that until she's able to say that forgiveness prayer. And her back started to be better. We prayed specifically over the back through laying of hands, graciously. And she got better to the point she could sit up. We prayed different things. And she felt much better, but she still had pain in her back. So we prayed as long as I felt we were supposed to pray. Next year, I came back to the same congregation, and I looked up at the worship team. This lady had been completely healed. She had just an anointing over her in worship and love for the Father you could see visibly. And I had her give her testimony because it's so dramatic a change. So that
you
is...
You didn't even recognize her initially.
I didn't recognize her because of the transformation.
Wow.
And that, to me, spoke volumes about the love of the Father and desire to bring healing. And that really stays up here in my head, my spirit, as a fond memory.
Wow. This is Your Issues Live with Greg Savary and Alvin Daly. If you're just listening in, you're listening to Frank and Robbie Pang. They are missionaries, and they will be going on a missionary trip very soon to what country, Frank?
To Ukraine.
To Ukraine. And how long will you be staying in Ukraine?
This trip will be about 2 weeks. The longest we've been there is 3.5 weeks. At a time. And we have been on 3 trips a year. This will be my 17th trip in the last 10 years.
Wow.
And my, what is it, 13th or 14th?
13th trip. So, Robbie, you want to tell me some of the country, or tell the listeners some of the countries that you have been to?
I've been to Brazil on 6 teams, Mozambique, France, a very short trip to Austria on my way home from Ukraine at one point. And the one that we had trouble getting prayer support for was Bermuda. Frank and I both went to Bermuda. The others, I went by myself, or with other people, I should say. Bermuda, they gave us a hard time because they were like, oh, tough mission field. But it was because they were wanting to do some special changes in Bermuda. And it rained the whole time we were there anyway.
You know something, Alvin, when I'm listening to Robbie and to Frank, it amazed me how these people love Christ, to actually put themselves in ways and making sure that they actually go out to minister the word to these people. But what I really want to, one of the questions that I really want to ask you is, Frank, is what part of missionary work do you enjoy the most?
I believe the most important thing to me is really seeing the move of the Holy Spirit to confirm that the book of Acts and the events of Jesus' time are for today also. They didn't stop then. The Bible never says it stops. In fact, it says the opposite. Jesus said in John 14 that we will do greater works than he did.
Definitely.
And I took that to heart, and I always, Lord, you have to come now. Let me be sensitive to see what you're doing, and then bless it and be part of it. And but above all, the very crux of all of our ministry is, first and foremost, to stay in a close friendship relationship with Jesus. That is where all ministry should come from, is that relationship with the heart.
Definitely. And as you see, as we're here and we're talking, it's a wonderful thing to really sit down and to talk about God, because the more you talk about God, you realize the more you're connected with him, because the more, it's just like going to school. The more you read, the more you study, the more you understand.
It's a jungle out there, a lot of hungry people out there, oh yeah. Child and troubles out there, it's so hard to be humble out there. Hear me now, it's your issues live, you know, on WDJZ.
Frank, what do you have to say to someone who really would like to go on the battlefield for Christ? How do they go about doing something like that?
Well, I can tell you what God did in me is this, that even when Robbie went our first trip, that God was doing a deep work in me, and I stayed home for a period of a year and asked the Lord to come and to bring healing to my soul and all the pain of the past. And so every night I went to bed and just invited the Holy Spirit to come and to minister to my inner healing, to me, inner healing. And then I was prepared to go. He made it clear. But I had to get that relationship and also my own personal healing to the point where I felt God wanted to release me. And I think in my heart a long time ago, in church 25 years ago, I heard the word taught by wonderful pastors, but what I didn't see happening very much of was that which is spoken of in the book of Acts. And I didn't see many people following the command of the Lord to go forth. And I knew that the time would come. God had told me that one day. He was preparing me, but 25 years later, it actually happened. So there was a call. He spoke to me in 1982, and then it's roughly, 19 years later that he actually called me forth, and that was a time of preparation.
And at that time, I told him, well, perhaps God is going to have to get you a new wife, because I couldn't see me going into the mission field at that point.
Your issues lie.
God did give him a new wife, but not in the way that I was joking about. It was that he brought me through different things in life, some of them not easy, some of them trials and tribulations, that humbled me to the point that I was willing and able, or desperate really, for change of some sort. And then because we met Randy Clark and became familiar with the organization of Global Awakening, and they take teams not just to go and, you know, pray behind the scenes or just pay the bills for the speaker to go, but they believed in the average man on the streets, the average Christian in the pews, doing what God calls them to do in various levels and various settings. And they bring people on teams and pray over them, share their anointing with them, give them the tools and the training to know how to start. And then God fertilizes that, in a sense. And you start out with baby steps, and some people start out the first night and feel like they're learning how to walk with ice skates, and other people are skating around the lake the first night and doing wonderful things. But God takes each of us at our own pace in the way that He orchestrates to bring us to what He's called us each to do, whether it's in Ukraine or Mozambique or Brazil or in the U.S. You minister in the U.S. too, and you don't need a title to do it. You don't need maybe a big team to do it. You just need to do it.
Exactly. You know something, Alvin, what is running through my mind as Robert was talking, with some of the pastors, they do not want to go out in the missions. They on the mission field, they do not want to go, because a lot of people, they prefer to be in a comfortable home, a comfortable situation, a comfortable car. Right? I remember I listened to Paul Washer, and he mentioned that he went to a country where the Christians, they were going to church in a mudded shack. They had tires on their feet as shoe. They're all going to church and they are worshiping God. And oftentimes in church, if some people, they don't have a new suit to go to church, they will not go. Or if their hairstyle, exactly, or they are banned, you have to go, you have to look certain type of way, you have to afford to give certain amount of money to be a valuable member, and so forth. Now this leads a lot of Christians to go on the battlefield for themselves, to do the work of God and take it up in their own hand to do it. And I am happy that you too are doing that. You make me feel jealous here. I want to go somewhere, Alvin. Let's go to Ukraine with them. This is an awesome thing that you're doing, and I really want to thank you for being on the show. But I have another question here for you, Robbie, and this is something that you can share with our listeners. What's the most embarrassing or humiliating moment you have on the mission field?
Wow. There's a number of them. There was one. The bathroom facilities in many countries are a great embarrassment to our hosts, because they know that it's very different than we have here in the U.S. And we were at a small farmhouse in the middle of nowhere. We traveled a long time to get there. And
what country was that?
In Ukraine.
In Ukraine, okay. Mm-hmm.
But I have stories from other countries too. But we had a male interpreter, and eventually, you know, you need to use the facilities. And so they took the person who had the most English and the farm wife, and they apologized profusely because it wasn't, you know, something that they were proud of. And I walked this very long path with the two ladies, past a dog on a chain that was like an inch and a half from my leg. Oh. This dog was very fierce, and I, you know, went past the dog and all, and you become kind of equipped to bring your own paper and so forth to the facilities, and I was prepared that way. But we were out in the middle of wheat fields where there were very strong winds, and my guess is because of the strong winds without blocks, there was no window or little half moon or any kind of anything to let a touch of moonlight or something into the outhouse. And I opened up the door and I saw nothing but blackness. And all I could think of was, oh God, oh God, oh God, don't let me fall in. And I didn't, but I added to my list of supplies to bring to the outhouse a flashlight the next time, for once you close the door behind you. but step very, very small step inside and close the door right to your back end.
Wow. Now, I would love for you to pray for those people who their faith are not strong, and you out there, you know that your faith is not strong. This is a prayer that the missionaries are going to be praying for you. So please, be wise. Be wise.
Father, I just pray right now for those who are listening to the power of the Holy Spirit, that you would prick their hearts, that you'd awaken the hope within, and Lord, that you would awaken them to the reality of their divine destiny. I ask you to bring that deep in their spirit, Father, that you would stir them up and to draw them forth and remove the cobwebs off their mind and allow the cultural bondages that have been placed on the way they think, Father, some through churches and some through just society, Lord. But Lord, I ask you to start to raise up this generation into the divine destiny, that this culture in America will be transformed, that all the schemes of the enemy will be destroyed. Open their eyes to see, Lord. Open their eyes to see in the Spirit the reality of the supernatural in your kingdom, Father, in the name of Jesus.
And Lord, I ask that you send people into their lives who can speak about you, who can be God with flesh, who have walked through the things they've walked through. And God, I'm amazed at how you match people together, and send the one that they need to have sent to them. So Lord, send those people, send them, and let them speak your truth, Lord, into their lives about how you love them unconditionally. You've always loved them, and you have a future and a hope for them. And those parts of themselves that they dislike, you see good. You see yourself, Lord, working good out of that and turning it around to be used for your purposes in this world, whether it's in the U.S. or other countries. And Lord, those people who think that they're called to missions and just haven't had the right input or the right setting to be able to step out or to think they're ready to step out, Lord, I ask that you make things come together in such a way that they are called, like you did for me, with a friend calling and telling me about the meetings that Randy Clark was having the day of that the meetings were starting. I hadn't heard about them. Lord, let people speak up to other people. Give them the courage to talk about you. Give them the words. Give them the way.
This is Your Issues Live. You're listening to Greg Savary along with Alvin Daly and Robbie and Frank. We're coming to the end of the show, and of course we want to thank you listeners for listening. And of course, just as what Frank and what Robbie has been saying, it's not that bad on the mission field. It's really not bad. Of course, the bathroom, you have to understand that in the United States here, it's the facilities are going to be different. The beds are going to be different. Everything is going to be different. This is a developed country.